at all levels and spheres of leadership, from the presidency, from the ministers, from the local council, whoever, and everything, to the CEOs and everywhere, that once everyone is given power and their positions of power to influence anything, then they want to hijack the entire power, to take the entire chunk. It's me, I'm the president, it's me who does everything. Who does it? I don't want any system to work. It's me who is going to dictate ABCD, whatever. And then you leave a vacuum killing everything.
Yeah.
MDs in companies, they have to do the great divide and rule this one. They don't want to see a team that is me and the opposite of that exactly. And my work through that style becomes so easy because I empower people. I delegate.
Yeah.
Even if I'm not there, right, like I was on set,
yeah.
I left the set. It is running. Even if I didn't go there today, even if I didn't go there for a month, they'll meet, brainstorm stories, shoot flight content because they know. And that is the system I've created, that I empower people who are confident enough to come and talk to me because they're my friends and we'll iron out. And that is why you, like you talk. Thinking that, okay, if I go to school, I'll get, and the guys who went to school in their generation, the generation of our parents, got jobs.
Yes.
Those are the top CEOs you see in banks, bank manager and everything. That was the generation then.
Yeah.
But then as we were growing up, because our parents were not so keen in regards to seeing how generations change.
Yeah.
Our generations were changing, but for them, they didn't see that it was changing in regards to the jobs were no longer there. Because you, when we left university, you couldn't get a job anywhere. You couldn't get a job in a bank, even if you're an accountant. You couldn't get a job in a law firm, even if you're a lawyer. You couldn't even get a job in a hospital, a doctor. So now, the issue was always, you have to be this, I want to be a lawyer, like, oh, and then most of us got lost there.
Yeah.
Yeah, and yet the world was changing. Yeah, so now the world has drastically changed. So now the jobs are not going to be there anymore that those guys are thinking. So I looked at myself definitely in the eyes of my parents because they wanted me to be a lawyer, to be a teacher. Mm-hmm. And that those are the first two courses I put in my ethics to field for university, law and education. Then accidentally I was put drama as a third option because remember when you're filling those forms, you have to get the course with the high points, then you do to balance, to be
then
able
you
to
balance,
stand a chance.
You go to the medium one, then you go to the very low one. If you don't get this one, this is what you get. Yeah.
So that's what I did. So I did put law first, education second, drama was just a by the way to fill the space. I put a bachelor's degree in drama.
Yeah.
I go sit my exams, results come back, and I've been admitted on government scholarship at bachelor's degree at Makerere to do drama.
Yes.
I was confused. I almost changed to social sciences because then peer pressure.
Yeah.
Hey, you're going to do drama, what will you do? Where will you get the job?
Yeah.
So there was a lot of, I was in a mental dilemma.
Yeah.
I even picked the forms. But on my way to God change them, I met the professor who was the head of department at the music, dance and drama department at Kerry at that time.
Yes.
He was called Professor Justinian Tamsuza. He's still there to this day.
Yeah.
So he explained to me what I can be and what I can achieve if I did a bachelor's degree in drama. And he told me actually, a bachelor's degree in drama was a professional course and social sciences was a flat course, albeit so it was done for someone to switch from a professional course to a flat course.
Yes.
That is where I stood firm and said I'm going to do drama. And this is what has become of me.
So on that note, were you funny from the beginning as a child?
I've always been funny. I've always acted. You know, because of my size, I'm short. Yes. That's why you see I come as a monkey. For me to stand out or to be felt or to be unfair, so I had to develop that humorous bit of me. Because you can't impact like in giants if my hobbies were like you.
Yes.
No one would see you. Every time you'd be talking, they would either give you golo. But because of my humor and my overtalk talking, so they always loved me and kept me around. So that's why I developed that side of me.
Wow. Yeah. Annington, that said, and then, did you ever see yourself becoming who you are today in life by any chance?
Yeah. Not what I've become today, but I always thought I would be successful no matter what job or profession I did.
Yeah.
Because I've hustled a lot. I've been a tax conductor, I've owned taxis, I've owned border borders, I've quite a lot of kiosks, I've owned Rolex stalls, I've owned mobile money joints, I've owned telephone, you know, you understand? So it was about being successful and living a comfortable life.
Yeah.
So I knew that, but at whichever profession I would take, Whether I would be on the street, whether I'd be, I thought I would be somewhere. That was my drive ever. I didn't know how I would get there, but I knew for a fact if I stood on my principles, on my hard work, on my focus, I knew I would somehow make it in life.
Wow.
Yes.
And how do you feel today where you are today, having gone through this journey?
Eddie, it's a long story and long journey.
Yes.
And we're still going, not that we have reached.
Yes.
We have not even reached half. Yes. It's just, but we have to be appreciative to God.
Yes,
because not all our peers or age mates are like us, especially in the arts.
Yes.
Where we're trying to pioneer, to spearhead, to lead a revolution, to professionalize the arts. You've been in the journey at least for many years, and it's been hard because we were talking before we came about content.
Yes.
The guys who should be buying our content want us to give them money
for free to learn, free to learn,
which is crazy.
Yeah.
It only happens in Uganda.
Yeah.
So this is the lobbying we are taking up with the leaders. Mm. It should stop because we are killing our culture.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now we are getting a lot of garbage and junk from abroad.
Yeah.
Our young children are watching things that happened 20 years ago, 15 years ago in Asia, in India, in Philippines and everything, in all radios and TVs, in particular, those Philippine soaps and series.
Yes.
The government is sleeping, not knowing that our culture is being buried.
Yeah.
Within 10 years, a generation will be dead. They will be watching Baku, and they will know more about the Asian cultures than they know about the Ugandan culture. And they will know more about the Nigerian cultures than they know about the Ugandan cultures.
Yes.
And eventually, that's why you'll see then the other bad practices that the government is fighting when it's too late, when they're already now infiltrated in people.
Yeah.
So we are on a journey to tell government, wake up. We are the new kings. Content creation is the new gold.
Yeah.
Even by the time they start exploiting that oil, it may be desolate, may be useless.
Yeah.
But our creativity, it is on the point. It is everywhere. Nigeria is earning more money in its ICT technology entertainment industry than it is in oil.
Yeah.
Many countries are doing. America is doing the same. So these are the things that we are lobbying, telling government, wake up. We know you are old. You don't understand these things. Your generation is gone, but there is a new vibe in the world.
Yeah.
Yeah. Guys are becoming millionaires just because of creativity. One simple thing, something viral, their life will never be the same.
Yeah.
So we're trying to plug a lot of stuff, which is not easy,
yeah.
But once we start somewhere, we're going to move. We're going to
move
leaps and bounds.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well,